I'm not showing up.
There's that, and also I don't know if I had the right link.
You started it though, right?
Yeah. The other one. Yeah, I started. And this mic is working this time.
Did you set screen too?
No, I didn't. That's.
I'm just gonna make sure. Yeah, I'll do it right there. Can you please check if it's working? It was just open when I just got here. So let's just share this link. It's okay. Wait, how long is this?
It's 3 hours.
Then it's okay, right? Yes, it's really good job. Should we do that now?
Is it a tip?
Can you just check it out? Like, just point it.
Thank you. Okay, folks, if you don't mind, it's a really long lecture today as well. We have a lot of slides to get through. I need to make sure that I get through all the material before you have your turn test on Tuesday, so it'd be great if we could get started. So in the last lecture that we left off with, we sort of had an overview of the visual system and the transduction, the phototransduction of how a receptor, a photoreceptor in your retina at the back of your eye, takes a photon of light and actually converts it into an electrical signal that your brain can understand. And what we ended up doing was we stopped at the section that dealt with how a photoreceptor changes its membrane potential. And again, it's all about the membrane potential. And we're going to be talking about this system here today. There's some sort of mechanical stimulus or a photon of light or something that interacts with a specific receptor, which will then activate a neuron that sends a signal into the brain. And all of the different signals and all of the different systems that we're going to be looking at today for the remainder of today's lecture all deal with that same basic principle, that somehow a signal that your brain cannot understand gets transduced or converted into an electrical signal through a neuron that your brain can understand in the form of action potentials. So we had spoken about in the last lecture about changes in the membrane potential, whether that is an activation like sodium coming into the cell and causing depolarization, or in other cases, hyperpolarizing the membrane. And again, we'll come back and review this when we talk about the visual system in a few moments. At the end of the last lecture, when I told you that you should go back and start reviewing what happens to the photoreceptor, and we talked about rods, it's exactly the same for cones, what happens to those photoreceptors in the light versus what happens to them in the dark? And contrary to what we would normally assume, something stimulates a neuron, it should be activated. It turns out that light, the signal that we've been waiting for, actually ends up closing that cation channel, that cyclic GMP-dependent sodium channel that we were looking at closes when light actually hits the photoreceptor, and this causes the hyperpolarization of that photoreceptor's membrane. And this is sort of where we left off. So again, just to go back and review a few things, so all receptors have a threshold, and we'll be talking about that threshold a little bit today. It's that minimal stimulus that will activate that receptor to begin this whole process of signal transduction. So it could be an action potential in the receptor itself. We haven't seen that example yet, but we'll see it in the somatosensory system, or it could be the activation of a downstream sensory neuron that generates these action potentials. Photoreceptors, some of them, the ones that are found in the macula or in the fovea centralis, are very, very sensitive to photons of light, and they can respond to photons of light that induce color. Your rods are sensitive to light, and they're the ones that are the most sensitive to single photons of light. Chemoreceptors that we'll be talking about today can, in theory, respond to one single odorant molecule, but the reality is that this receptor threshold is different than the actual perceptual threshold. If you had like one molecule of an odorant molecule in this lecture theater, my guess is that none of you would actually be able to detect at a perceptual level that this new odor has entered into this classroom. So it depends on a number of factors. This goes back to that sort of flow diagram that I showed you earlier on about attention. If you're not paying attention to the stimulus that's coming in, actually you can block the overall perception of what you are trying to detect. So you might be drowsy, you might be thinking about something else, you might be distracted by another sensory system. All of those things could potentially change this perceptual threshold. So again, we also spoke about the fact that we have specific receptors for specific types of stimuli. So if it's light, we have photoreceptors. Light does not activate hair cells. It does not activate any other types of receptors. The hair cells that we'll be talking about later today only respond to sound. They don't respond to light, nor do they respond to other sorts of things. And this sensory receptor encodes for a sensory modality so that we can make sense of what we are perceiving in the outside world around us. And we know that this is hardwired in terms of the axons going back to specific areas of the brain. And we call this idea that specific sensory receptors that are specific to a signal or a stimulus has a specific labeled line that tells you that you are seeing something through your photoreceptors and you are using your visual system. It should be going back to the occipital lobe where the processing of what you're seeing goes on. It wouldn't go to the auditory cortex, for example. I had a really great question that was asked during the break in the last lectures. Some of you will know that sometimes it's possible for you to actually have individuals that can see sound, or they can taste certain other sensations. Do you know what that is called? Sorry? Synesthesia. Synesthesia has nothing to do with the wrong receptors going on the wrong labeled lines. We think that what happens in those individuals, the brain areas that help to decode things, actually may sprout into other areas, and so they may be receiving other signals from other areas. We're not 100% sure, but synesthesia has nothing to do with these labeled lines or these modalities. They have something to do with the central processing going on in the brain. So we're going to be looking at this visual pathway. Again, if you're looking at this and you're seeing like little flashes of light in between the vertices of the black squares, the reason why you're seeing these little flashes is because as you're looking at this black and white picture, the rods in your eyes are actually adapting, they're photo bleaching, and then as you move to another area, it kind of leaves a little gray zone where the photoreceptors have bleached. And this is actually a useful reminder of how this visual pathway works. And again, this is a slide that I had covered with you earlier, so you should know that these cones are great for visual acuity. They're great for color vision. They are fantastic at having a one-to-one-to-one relationship between the bipolar cell and the ganglion cells. And this is in contrast to the rods that are beside it. They're great at detecting low levels of light. They're really good at detecting low levels of light. We use these when we're seeing things in the dark, but they also exhibit a property known as convergence. And you can actually see convergence here. We have two rods actually converging on one bipolar cell. Here we have one cone. This is that one cone that is not converging. It is making a one-to-one relationship or synaptic connection with the bipolar cell. So all of the photo transduction occurs out here in the outer segment. All of the nuclei, the mitochondria, the organelles are found here in this inner segment. This is where ATP is produced, etc. And then this pigmented layer contains that vitamin A that we talked about in the last lecture as well. So again, we're going to be talking about the rest of the pathway, not the photoreceptive pathway that we've already looked at, but the rest of the pathway this evening. So I'd also mentioned that you should probably go back because it is one of those outstanding biochemical pathways that actually won a Nobel Prize for the elucidation of this biochemical pathway that's involved in vision. You should probably go back and make sure that you understand what happens in those rods, both in the light as well as in the dark. And I'll talk about that very briefly. And you should know about the different molecules like rhodopsin, which consists of the opsin protein, and then the retinal that is derived from vitamin A. Okay, and you should know that pathway from the last lecture. So in the dark, it is a completely different type of system than it is in the light. And I'm going to show you this diagram again really briefly because it helps to reinforce a couple of concepts. We had talked about the rods and cones, and we had talked about how the cones have these other pigments that consist of not rhodopsin. Do you guys remember what the molecule was? So it was the iodopsin. So we have an iodopsin that responds best to the blue, another iodopsin that responds best to the green wavelengths, and another that responds best to the red wavelength. And then we have the rods that sit sort of in the middle of all of this. So the entire spectrum, everything from the short wavelength all the way to the red wavelength, almost to the far infrared, is covered by all of the different rods and cones with the different molecules that are found within them. The overall ratio of the different types of activity, for example, how do you deduce? We don't have a photoreceptor, we don't have a cone that will actually tell us about the color orange. We don't have an orange photopigment. The way that your brain deduces it is it makes an average, or it makes a guess based on the number of cones that are being excited by green wavelengths, the number of cones that are being excited by red wavelengths by this orange light hitting it, and the number of rods that are hitting it, and it is able to deduce by the firing of all of these different types of photoreceptors that this is supposed to represent the color orange, which is outlined for you here at the last bullet point. So this is where things are going to get a little bit confusing for some of you, because there are different cell types that I need you to remember within the retina. And I'm going to go through this sort of in a slightly different way than you had in the last sort of lecture. So what we're looking at is these photoreceptors and those bipolar cells. They don't actually fire action potentials. That's okay. I told you on the very first slide today that sometimes we have these receptor cells that change their membrane potential, and both these photoreceptors and the next cells that are in line, the bipolar cells, they only change their receptor potentials. They either generate an excitatory postsynaptic potential, they become more excited, in other words, or they become more inhibited and they generate what's known as an inhibitory postsynaptic potential. They hyperpolarize, if you want to think of it that way. So when light is hyperpolarizing photoreceptors, those photoreceptors that we looked at, the rods in particular, they will actually stop releasing glutamate. Now, normally you think of glutamate in the context that you learned with Dr. Key. What did you learn about glutamate? Is it excitatory or inhibitory? So most of the time in the central nervous system, when we're talking about glutamate, and 80% of your neurons in your brain consist of excitatory neurons, only 20% consist of inhibitory neurons, most of the time you think glutamate equals excitation. I'm going to try to convince you that glutamate that's being released by these photoreceptors all the time in the dark can potentially be inhibitory. Not always, but in some cases. And you need to be able to understand those some cases that we're going to come to. So this inhibitory glutamate, and we'll just call it inhibitory glutamate for the time being, it's no longer being released. It stopped being released. So if glutamate was inhibitory and it was blocking the activity of the next cell down by the bipolar cells, no more glutamate. If again, I can convince you that it is indeed inhibitory. If that inhibition is now lost because the neurotransmitter is no longer being released, these bipolar cells that have been stopped before now can start to depolarize. They were previously inhibited by glutamate from depolarizing, but now they can start to depolarize. They themselves can now start to release neurotransmitter as they depolarize onto those next ganglion cells that we are going to be taking a look at. And these are the cells, the ganglion cells. They're the ones that generate true action potentials into the brain, into the central nervous system via this optic nerve. Do you have any questions on this before we go on? Okay, so this is the same sort of diagram shown to you in a slightly different way, but you should still be able to understand the major points behind this. So we are talking about these rods, could also be cones, but we have many, many more rods, 20 to 1 versus cones. So it's actually better for us to talk about these rods. So when light hits this rod cell and it goes through the stack of membranes that contain rhodopsin, this light will actually activate the retinal. It goes from 11 cis to 11 trans. It makes a conformational change, And as a result of this conformational change, it activates a G protein, and this G protein then activates another molecule. Do you remember what that other molecule is? So in light, what's the other enzyme or the other molecule that gets activated? Anyone? I think I hear some people sort of mentioning bits and pieces of it. Phosphodiesterase gets activated. Phosphodiesterase now breaks down this cyclic GMP. And the cyclic GMP in the dark has been holding open the cation channel that has allowed sodium to be flowing in and depolarizing the cell. The cyclic GMP now is being broken down by this newly activated phosphodiesterase. And as a result, this whole photoreceptor starts to hyperpolarize. In this hyperpolarization, these voltage-gated calcium channels that were down here in the terminal can no longer work. No more calcium flows in through these photoreceptors, and as a result, there is no more neurotransmitter, in this case glutamate, being released. So this means that now, in this cell, glutamate actually is no longer being poured onto this cell, and as a result of this, this means that this bipolar cell can now start to depolarize. This cell that's now starting to depolarize does exactly the same thing. The depolarization in this bipolar cell will start to open these voltage-dependent calcium channels down here in the terminal. The calcium channels open, calcium flows through, it interacts with these various snare protein complexes that allows the neurotransmitter vesicles to fuse with the presynaptic membrane, causing the release of the neurotransmitters onto the ganglion cells. These ganglion cells immediately respond to the release of this neurotransmitter, and it fires an action potential as long as it reaches a threshold. And usually when neurotransmitter is released at the synapse, it usually results in the release of or the generation of action potentials. Do you have any questions on this before we go on? Because it's important that you understand this. Yes?
So the bipolar cell depolarizes because there's no...
Yes, correct. Okay. There's no more neurotransmitter being released onto it.
So
before, previously, it has been held in a hyperpolarized state by that. And you'll understand the reason why when I get to the on-off bipolar cells in a few moments. Yep, do you have a question? Sorry, the trigger zone in the ganglion cell?
Yeah.
So the trigger zone would just be the same sort of axon hillock region. Yep. Any other questions? Okay. So here's the overall topology. This is how the circuit actually starts to work. So we have these photoreceptors that we spent time on in the last lecture. And what you're seeing here is this idea of convergence. So we have 1, 2, 3 photoreceptors converging onto this one bipolar cell. And again, you have another 1, 2, 3 photoreceptors converging onto this one bipolar cell. And we have 2 bipolar cells converging onto this one ganglion cell. This is this idea of convergence. In some places in the retina, you can have up to 45 photoreceptors converging onto eventually one ganglion cell. So I told you that we have about 250 million photoreceptors in the eye. We do not have 250 million ganglion cells running out of the back of the eye. We have about 1 million. So you have to think about how these are all converging so that each of those photoreceptors converges onto bipolar cells, which in turn converge onto ganglion cells. So all of them are containing different information, which means that this information that is going backwards from the rods is actually being condensed in terms of the action potentials that will be generated into the CNS. Okay, and again, the other thing to make note of, the convergence, where you have this phenomenon going on where it's more than just 3 to 1 bipolar and 2 bipolars onto one ganglion, is actually the greatest in the periphery, outside of the fovea centralis, and it's the least. We have none of this convergence right in the middle of the fovea centralis, where it's 1 to 1 with the bipolar cells. One other thing to make note of, when you are starting to look at vision, so here we're having photoreceptors being activated, they are turning on and turning off some of these bipolar cells. Some of those bipolar cells are then signaling to these ganglion cells. It's not a perfect sort of on-off relationship. There are other cells that we are not going to spend a lot of time on that are also found within the retina that are called amacrine cells. And we're going to see amacrine cells again in the olfactory system. These amacrine cells will make synapses with both bipolar cells as well as with ganglion cells. And you can see that sort of amacrine cell right here. And then we also have these horizontal cells that will also make synapses between the photoreceptors that you see here and the bipolar cells underneath them. So there's a way to regulate the activity of both photoreceptors and bipolar cells through these horizontal cells at the same time. And we can have these amacrine cells that modulate the activity simultaneously of the bipolar and ganglion cells. So it's not a simple system. We don't have time to cover all of this complexity, but I'm going to ask you to remember these two different cell types that will influence how information gets relayed backwards into the ganglion cells that we see here. So this may answer your colleague's question that we had earlier on. So why do these bipolar cells respond through hyperpolarization? Shouldn't it be depolarization? It turns out that there are actually at least two bipolar cells, or two types of bipolar cells. So we have one bipolar cell that we call an on bipolar cell. It's also called a light on bipolar cell. And these bipolar cells actually contain on their cell membrane, they contain a receptor that is metabotropic. Now, you guys have learned about metabotropic glutamate receptors with Dr. Key, am I correct? So what kind of receptors are those? So these are G-protein coupled receptors. So when on some of these light on bipolar cells, by working on a metabotropic glutamate receptor, the metabotropic glutamate receptor 6, or mGluR6, found on these bipolar cells, in the presence of glutamate, for example, these will actually hyperpolarize the bipolar cell when it encounters glutamate. So these cells are actually active in light, okay? And when there is less glutamate overall being secreted by these photoreceptors. So their normal job is to hyperpolarize, and they're there to hyperpolarize as long as glutamate is there. Glutamate is there, G-protein coupled receptors interact with glutamate, they're hyperpolarizing the cell, they're opening up these potassium channels, etc. They're hyperpolarizing the cell, keeping it turned in an off state. Now suddenly light hits, glutamate stops coming in, the metabotropic glutamate receptor that has been hyperpolarizing no longer functions because there's no more glutamate, and now this cell is starting to depolarize. Does that sort of answer your question from earlier about how this is regulated by glutamate?
Yes, but if the glutamate is always
In the dark, there's glutamate. This is hyperpolarized. It is generating an IPSP in the dark. In the light, there is no more glutamate there. It can't hyperpolarize through that G-protein coupled receptor.
But for it to be continuously hyperpolarized in the dark,
yes.
There's
no action potential. It's a graded potential coming from the photoreceptor. This is also a graded hyperpolarization, okay? So there is another type of bipolar cell, which is known as the off bipolar cell or the light off bipolar cell. These also have glutamate. Glutamate is the way that neurons like to communicate. And these bipolar cells have an ionotropic glutamate receptor. So when you see ionotropic, what does that mean for you? Or what does that imply? Sorry? It's an ion channel, yes, absolutely. When we say glutamate ionotropic, is it excitatory or inhibitory? So in the presence of glutamate, when glutamate binds to these ionotropic glutamate receptors, this will cause depolarization. Usually it causes sodium to flow in when glutamate binds to this ionotropic glutamate receptor. So we have some bipolar cells that respond to glutamate through a metabotropic receptor. And we have other classes of bipolar cells that actually work through these ionotropic glutamate receptors. So if you're working backwards, this means that these bipolar cells are only active when there is lots of glutamate around, and that means that they're only active when there is darkness that they are encountering. And again, let me just put something out there in terms of physiology. A lot of you are thinking like darkness being only when you're talking about day and night. So absolutely no light around versus like having lots of light around during the daytime. And that's true. Your eye works that way. All these receptors work that way. But you're actually looking at a black and white signal on this slide. And this black and white signal are activating some of these on-off receptors as well, because they are dark and they are also producing more light in this white background. So don't just think of it as day versus night, but also like light versus dark in terms of text and other types of things. So a couple of things before we go on into how this all gets put together. So the next cells in line are these ganglion cells, and the receptive fields, how these ganglion cells respond electrophysiologically vary with location depending where they are in the retina. So ganglion cells, the ones that are the closest to the fovea, the one that is has the highest visual acuity, have the smallest receptive fields. A very small pinpoint of light can activate these ganglion cells. And part of that is we don't need to activate a whole bunch of photoreceptors. It's almost one-to-one before these ganglion cells become activated. And this is one of the reasons why our visual acuity is so high. Like, you can tell the difference between letters or the number of fingers I'm holding up. The visual acuity that you are experiencing is because the ganglion cells in your fovea have very, very small receptive fields. Ganglions in the periphery of the retina, though, have very, very large receptive fields. You have to activate a whole bunch of these photoreceptors before that ganglion cell actually becomes activated. There's a lot of convergence, in other words, going on here, because they're receiving so much input from so many of these other photoreceptors. And as a result, we can't really distinguish like where that point of light is coming from. So you have to be able to stimulate this big, huge area, but you can't tell like where in that area that light is actually coming from. And these receptive fields of these ganglion cells are really important. They sometimes tell us about how well you can see, why you see things the way that you do, and they allow us to start putting together larger images. These receptive fields, by the way, are roughly circular. So we also say that these receptive fields of these ganglion cells have what is known as a center surround. And this ganglion cell, for example, there would be a ganglion cell associated with this. There would be photoreceptors associated with this ganglion cell. And what this means is, if we were to shine light on the receptive field of this ganglion cell, it would be a circular beam of light that would activate it best. And if we were to activate it right in the center of its receptive field, if we're trying to map it out, sort of like doing the battleship and you're trying to figure out where the receptive field is, if we hit the center, the ganglion cell in this particular case would fire very, very rapidly. Lots of action potentials would go, telling the ganglion cell that it should be active if it hits it in this particular center. If, for example, we hit light on the surround, though, if we hit it out in this region, that ganglion cell would actually turn off. And so what we can do by mapping this out is that this particular ganglion cell, as we shine light, we are recording from one ganglion cell, and as we're shining light on different regions of the retina, we would be able to map out that this one ganglion that we are measuring from has what is known as an on center and an off surround, where light falling on the center excites this ganglion cell, and it is inhibited if light falls on the surrounding regions, okay? So it would start turning on and turning off depending on where light would be falling. There is also an inverse ganglion cell. There's a ganglion cell where if you shine light right in the center of its receptive field, it's still circular, But if you were to shine light on here, it would actually turn that ganglion cell action potential off. And if you shone light on the surrounding area, it would actually be excited. You would actually see action potentials starting up again. And this allows us, if you're thinking about it, why have like these little flashes of light? Why have these circular fields? If you line up a whole bunch of these small little dots, you'll get lines. And if you have edges to these lines where you have these surrounds, you're going to be able to start building up images. So small dots make lines, make corners, make boxes, make squares, and make complex figures. We can do this because of these different center surrounds. And both of these, by the way, are weakly active if light falls on the entire thing. So I've been talking to you about a theoretical sort of way to map it, but if light hit the entire field, not just this little portion here, but everywhere on this receptive field, then it would just be weakly active, not strongly excited. To make things even more complicated, because I know you guys love having complicated physiology, right? It's like your favorite thing in the whole world, like add more difficulty to this entire process, give me more. Okay, so here's some more. There are specific subclasses of these ganglion cells as well that help us to identify these ganglion cells. So we have these really large ganglion cells. They're large in terms of the axon diameter, and these are known as magnocellular or large ganglion cells. Sometimes they're abbreviated as M cells, and what they do is they respond best where you have little flashes of light onto their receptive field, but these flashes of light move across their receptive field. They're there, those ganglion cells respond best when things are moving in your visual field. So when you're seeing my arm waving around right now, I'm stimulating your M magnocellular ganglion cells at the back of your eye. Now this is in contrast to the other types of ganglion cells, these parvocellular ganglion cells, also called P cells, and what they do is they try to receive as much information about texture of the surface that you're looking at, as much fine detail about a particular object that you're looking at as possible. So we have two different things, one that's really, really good at detecting motion, and the other one is really good at when you're just staying still and you're trying to see something in as much detail as possible, you're using two sets or two different sets of these ganglion cells. Together, most of your retina are classified either as magnocellular M cells that detect motion or are the P cells, parvocellular cells, which are really good at discriminating fine detail. Okay, so we have this way in the eye already to look and detect motion versus looking for fine detail at the level of these ganglion cells. That 20% though, if you're doing the math, the 20%, there's a lot of controversy about this, and we're gonna come back to this other class of ganglion cells. A class of ganglion cells has been shown to contain another protein known as melanopsin. So the photoreceptors, we know the rods have rhodopsin, the cones have iodopsin, and now we're talking about the ganglion cells, not photoreceptors, but the ganglion cells. These melanopsin-containing ganglion cells themselves might act as a type of photoreceptor. Now, you can see why that might be really controversial, right? There's this circuit that's being built up in the eye, photoreceptors, bipolar cells, then ganglion cells that fire in terms of light. Now, some neurobiologists are suggesting that melanopsin-containing ganglion cells directly detect light themselves. They don't need to get as much information from the photoreceptors. And they contain this special opsin-like pigment, like rhodopsin, like iodopsin, called melanopsin. Interestingly, their axons will project to a specific area in the brain known as the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And this nucleus that we're going to come back to later on in the course is important in circadian rhythms, the day, light, and nighttime rhythms that you have, that 24-hour clock where you're accustomed to waking up when it's really sunny out and going to sleep when it's really dark out. We think that these retinal cells actually help regulate or to make sure that you're following a circadian rhythm by the amount of light that they are detecting. So these melanopsin-containing cells, these retinal ganglion cells, seem to be really important for circadian-like activity. Okay, so just a couple of things about the anatomy of how all of this works. So we are looking at the back of the eye here, and at the back of the eye, the back half, is what we are calling the retina. So the retina contains the photoreceptors, bipolar, and ganglion cells. The ganglion cells are the ones that actually have axons. They're the ones that actually send out axons down this optic nerve. Same thing for the other eye. And these axons from the left eye and the right eye actually cross at the brain midline at what's known as the optic chiasm, and then they will send information to an area of the thalamus known as the lateral geniculate nucleus. And it will send it to the two sides on the lateral geniculate nucleus. And from there, the information is then sent to this primary visual cortex. And what part of the brain is the primary visual cortex found in? So it's the occipital lobe at the very back of your brain. And this primary visual cortex is where we begin to decode all this information. Again, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about binocular vision. It turns out that each half of your eye, the left eye, for example, the left side in red that you see here, will send projections to the left side of the left thalamus, the lateral geniculate thalamus, nucleus of the thalamus, and then into the left cortex, the visual cortex, and the right side does exactly the same thing from each eye. The right side of the right eye, the right side of the left eye send their axons together to the right side of the lateral geniculate thalamus, and then we'll go into the right side of the occipital cortex. This allows you to have binocular vision. If the signals were being mixed up, you wouldn't be able to see in 3D. Your eye information from the left and right would be confusing. But this way we can actually keep the information from the left eye. When you close the left eye, you can still see with the right. You have this binocular vision because of the separation of the different axonal tracts. So those axons that we talked about, the million or so retinal ganglion axons, will eventually form this optic nerve. They will decussate. Do you guys know what that word represents or what that means? Have you heard that before? I'm not sure I mentioned it in the last lecture, but it's a really important anatomical term. Decussation or decussate. Any ideas, guesses? Imagine it's your term test. You have a choice. You have to guess. C? Yes, okay. Not a good answer in this case, but never guess C, by the way. C is a really bad choice. Sorry? Crossing over. That's right. So decussation means crossing over. It goes from the left, and it crosses over to the right side. So there's decussation of these fibers at the optic chiasm, and then it will go into the lateral geniculate body, and it's just like one part of the thalamus. So the thalamus, we're going to hear a lot about today, right? So you're going to hear about the thalamus when we talk about the auditory system. You're going to hear about the thalamus when we talk about the visual system, and we're going to talk about the thalamus when we talk about your sense of balance. Most of your senses, except for your sense of smell, go through the thalamus. Each region of the thalamus, like your brain, has its own little nucleus. So the lateral geniculate is responsible for vision. That's the part of the thalamus responsible for vision. The posterolateral region of the thalamus is responsible for other sensations. So keeping all of these separated and all the signals separated is really important at the level of the thalamus, and eventually these will then go into the primary visual cortex within the occipital lobes. So they actually start to flare out, and if you go back to that diagram here, this is that optic radiation. They spread out. If you radiate, it means that you're spreading out. And this optic radiation that you see here goes and hits many different targets within the primary visual cortex in that occipital lobe. So you will also send other optic tract fibers, not just to the geniculate, but also to the superior colliculi. And the superior colliculi are important for initiating various eye-related reflexes. And again, we'll come back to these reflexes after your term test. But if you were to hear a sound on this side of the room, suddenly someone opened the door and closed it really loudly, your eye would automatically track there. Automatic eye movements involve these different colliculi and these visual reflexes, and the superior colliculus is really important for these visual reflexes, like being able to track noise that you hear and being able to see where that sound came from. That would be an example of a visual reflex. So we've already talked about these really small sets of ganglion cells that contain melanopsin, probably important in circadian rhythms. And these will also project to the suprachiasmatic nucleus that I mentioned to you before, found in the hypothalamus, maybe a timer for daily biorhythms. Not really sure. To be honest, a lot of you will hear about, for example, jet lag, resetting your circadian rhythm. And what are you told you're supposed to do when you are going overseas and it's a completely different time zone? So what have you heard about doing to reset your circadian rhythm? Don't sleep, go to sleep, okay, correct, sure. What else have you heard? How many of you have heard of like light therapy or using light to reset your circadian rhythm? Have you heard of that at all? Not so much, because there's no concrete evidence. There's no evidence-based practice in the literature that's consistent that actually says that it works for everyone. So we're not 100% sure if this visual pathway involving the suprachiasmatic nucleus can be reset, the melanopsin can be reset. And again, it's one of those really controversial areas in neuroscience. And these pretectal nuclei also get these melanopsin-containing fibers going in, and these might be involved in the pupillary reflex that we talked about in the last lecture. So you don't have to worry about this particular diagram. It's there to show you the complexity of the circuit that goes from the back of your retina to the area of the thalamus, where it radiates out into the occipital region. And from here, it doesn't stop. Actually, it gets spread out over many regions of your cortex. But this trisynaptic connection from the retina to the thalamus, from the thalamus then into the occipital lobe, is a really important, well mapped out sort of pathway that as neurobiologists we're really interested in. That's just part of the joy of looking at the visual system, though. So understanding the biochemistry is really important, and it's really good, but your eyes actually do a lot more than just look at things and detect texture. Your eye right now, in theory, is actually seeing another triangle here. You're filling in the gaps, right? That doesn't involve your photoreceptors. It does not involve your thalamus. It does not involve even your occipital cortex. It involves none of those things. In fact, what you're doing is you're using the other association areas or the association cortices in your brain to actually fill in some of the gaps that are missing. And that's really the incredible part of the visual system that we're going to be talking about. So the retinal ganglion cells, again, tell us lots of information. They tell us information about the color of something that you're looking at, how bright something is or how dark something is. It tells us if something is moving. It tells us if there are edges. It tells us about all sorts of different things. And some of that it involves this lateral inhibition. In order for us to see things well, you have to actually be able to detect an edge to it, where one thing stops and another thing begins. And that is the job of those amacrine cells and the horizontal cells. Do you remember those cells from the first part of today's lecture? Do you kind of remember those? So I want you to equate those with lateral inhibition. And when these cells are working between the photoreceptors and bipolar cells, in the case of the horizontals, or between the bipolar cells and the retinal ganglion cells, in the case of the amacrine, they're the ones that actually allow us to start seeing edges through generating lateral inhibition. And it gives us this capacity for building up images like this. So the visual processing actually starts at the level of the thalamus, very, very crudely. That's the first synapse from the retina. It goes back to the lateral geniculate in the thalamus. And this helps us to start seeing things in terms of depth perception. It's here. If you had a stroke on this part of your thalamus, you would have problems with depth perception. Color is emphasized here in the lateral geniculate. Contrast is sharpened at the level of the lateral geniculate. And then they will send information from here into the primary visual cortex. It's also called the striate or stria cortex. And here we're actually able to find neurons that respond to dark and bright edges. They tell us how things are oriented in space. They respond really well to different objects, different colors, different motion inputs. All of these things take place at the level of the primary visual cortex. The other thing to make note of, when we're talking about the thalamus and the primary visual cortex, if you see something in this part of your visual field, so something on the right, and then you see something right beside it, it's always organized topographically. In the thalamus, it's organized, something here is beside, immediately beside it, the neurons are in that same topographical order, and it goes all the way into the primary visual cortex. We always maintain spatial integrity. If something was seen in the visual cortex, visual field on my right, it always stays in that orientation from the lateral geniculate all the way through to the visual cortex. So these occipital lobes and parts of the occipital lobes, like the anterior pre-striate cortices, process more detail about the form, what you're looking at, the colors that you're looking at. They will detect whether you're looking at something red versus orange versus yellow, so that decoding occurs there. It will also start to engage in complex visual processing as well, and it will send some of that information in order to process what is being looked at visually, in terms of like what you're looking at. That information from the occipital lobe is then sent by axons to the ventral temporal lobe to try to figure out what you're looking at in the visual field. So did you actually remember the particular street that you're walking on, what visual cues, the what part is here in the temporal lobe, the where processing of the spatial location of objects. So relative to these other recorders, where is the recorder that I just had? And this is at the level of the parietal cortex. And again, there are other regions that will also help to direct movement associated with this. But if you're thinking about this, it's not just the occipital lobe, it's the temporal lobe, it's part of the parietal lobe. Remember that figure that I showed you earlier, that 50% of your brain is actually involved in visual processing. And this is where some of those figures come in. Do you think vision is really therefore important to you, if so much of your brain is involved in this? Well, you can try this experiment sometime when you're not on campus and I don't have to worry about being sued. I tried this. It's really, really hard. We're really accustomed to using our brains for visual input all the time. So I did this a few years back with my daughter. I like going to the local mall. And as we're walking around the mall, I just asked my daughter, I'm going to close my eyes. I'm going to try walking for as long as I possibly can with my hand on your shoulder. And I want to see how long I can do that. How long do you think I was able to close my eyes, walk around without opening them again? 1 minute? No, I'm not that good. But 20 seconds? I'm not that bad. So somewhere between 20 and 30 seconds, I became really uncomfortable, even though my daughter's guiding me around. And I trust my daughter a lot, so hopefully she's not listening in on this. Our brains are really accustomed to visual input. I felt very uncomfortable, as I think all of you would, if you were suddenly left to walk around in the dark or with your eyes closed. Even if someone was guiding you, you would have that temptation to open your eyes, because so much of our brain is actually related to visual processing of where, what, form, movement, color, etc. So I want you to maybe think about that a little bit in terms of what sorts of things our brains are actually really useful for. So this is all the different types of information that we've gone through. I want you, as you're going back over the notes, to spend some time on rhodopsin, transducent, what happens in the light versus dark. I want you to start thinking about the on-off bipolar cells and how they are linked to the ganglion cells. I want you to go back and think about and be comfortable with what amacrine cells are and what horizontal cells are from this particular section of the lecture. Okay, and I think as we get into the next sensory pathway, it's actually a really good time to take a break. If you have any questions from last lecture or from today's first part, I'll be happy to try to answer them.
Thank you. I
Okay, I had mentioned at the very end of the section on vision, and we're going to switch gears just a little bit. I'd mentioned that the thalamus was a really important relay center. Each portion of the thalamus, think of it almost like a little mini brain. The brain is separated out into different lobes that are responsible for different types of things. The thalamus is exactly the same. It's organized topographically, or organized by region, or organized by function, in other words, into specific sections that deal with things like vision versus things like hearing versus other types of somatosensation that we'll be getting into. And the thalamus is in this incredibly important relay center that you see here outlined in yellow. One of those senses, the olfactory sense, actually doesn't go through the thalamus. It goes directly into the olfactory cortex. And again, the equilibrium, the proprioceptive pathway, projects a little bit to the thalamus, but it will project mainly to another structure down here at the bottom known as the cerebellum. And we'll come back to those as we cover them later on in the course. So right now, we've been looking at transduction. We've been looking at photons being transduced into electrical signals at the level of the rods and cones in the retina, transmitting information to the bipolar cells, from the bipolars to the ganglion cells. And that was one method of transduction. But we also have these two other senses, both smell as well as taste, that actually make use of chemoreceptors. So both smell, the odorant, requires a molecule that binds to a receptor, and taste is exactly the same way. It activates your nervous system by having specific molecules that interact with specific receptors, and we call this together chemoreception. Okay? There are chemicals that are being detected that our nervous system is encoding as electrical signals. And I'm going to take you through both the sense of smell very quickly, and again, concentrating on the biochemical pathways that allow this transduction to occur. And then I'll take you through taste. Taste is actually fairly complex. There are a multitude of different tastes and associated sensory things associated with taste. And I'll take you through both of these in the second part of today's lecture. Again, because we're going through a lot of different things, feel free to stop me at any time if there's something that I can expand for you. So we know that chemoreception is a very, very old process. Bacteria use it. They use chemotaxis to move toward areas that have different concentrations of things. Animals without brains tend to use it, like C. elegans. C. elegans will migrate to different areas of food because they have chemo receptors that can detect different molecules. This chemoreception, in turn, may have developed into synaptic connectivity or synaptic connections. So we talk about neurotransmitters being released and being detected by receptors. Well, this might be a form or a modified version of the chemoreception that I'm going to be talking to you about in the next few slides. And the first instance of this is actually related to olfaction or smell and your ability to detect odorants. So if you were to take a look at the brain, this is the olfactory bulb that is sticking out here. There are sensory axons that are being sent up to this olfactory bulb, and there are other parts of that sensory the sensory dendrites that are sticking down into the nasal passage. And we're going to spend some time going through the anatomy of this structure here, and it's associated biochemistry. So if we were to take a look, these axons actually extend through the bones at the roof of your nose. And this cribriform plate that is somewhat spongy in appearance. This cribriform plate that you see in cross-section in this particular diagram allow for the different dendrites to be extending down into the olfactory region to be able to detect any odorants that come in when you breathe in through your nose, etc. So we're going to be looking at some of the different ways in which odorants bind here, how those chemicals, those odorants that you breathe in, how do you know that someone has been wearing Axe body spray or too much Axe body spray, and how do you actually detect that in terms of the odorants that go in. So again, just in passing, the olfactory pathway, the sense of smell, is the one that bypasses the thalamus, goes directly to the cortex. It also goes to other regions like the amygdala as well as the hippocampus. So if you really want to remember something, you will remember something associated with smell. So if you make that association, it's one that lasts for a long time because it involves emotion through the amygdala and it involves memory through things like the hippocampus. So I'm going to spend some time going over this structure. And when we're talking about this olfactory bulb that makes a projection directly into the cortex, we'll see that some of these sensory neurons, they send processes up through the bone, and they will also send other processes down through the olfactory epithelium, and they will make their endings will be in the level of the mucus inside your nose. Do you guys see any potential issues with this? Anything that you might think this is not a really well-engineered system? Or is it a really well-engineered system? No? Yes? The sensory neurons are in the middle. Yep, absolutely. And look how they're projecting up to these mitral cells that are found in the olfactory bulb. Any issues that you can think of? It's better than the visual one? Okay, it's all relative, sure, I guess so. Anything else that sort of sticks out for you? Yes? What if the bone breaks? Or what if you get hit in the nose and it moves the cribriform plate, and if the cribriform plate suddenly went this way, it would shear all of the sensory neuronal axons. So these different dendrites that are extending through, in theory, can be damaged. And it's one of those things that actually does happen. If you get hit in the nose, you can actually break some of the dendritic connections that you see here. Those single dendrites that are passing through can actually be severed, and your sense of smell may be affected as a result. If we're to take a look at this in some more detail, there's a couple of other things that sort of stand out here too. So it's not a complete loss, because unlike other parts of your nervous system, these sensory neurons that we see here that are sending out their dendrites upwards, which are passing through this cribriform plate, the bone, there are stem cells that you see here. And these stem cells actually can, at the basal layer, can actually repopulate, create new sensory neurons. So even if they're lost, in theory, as long as you're healthy, you can actually regrow some of those sensory neurons, even if they've been sheared off, if you've been hit in the nose and the dendrites have been cut. These stem cells can actually allow them to regrow. And they undergo this repopulation every few months. A couple of other things to make note of. This is where the actual chemoreception is going to take place. These cilia that are extending into the mucus layer in your nose are going to bind to the odorants down here at this level. When they bind here, if it depolarizes, the depolarization gets sent all the way up here, and it will eventually reach the mitral cells up in the olfactory bulb. So the Nobel Prize for elucidating all of the G proteins that are involved in olfaction was actually awarded to two different individuals for actually determining that we have a huge family of G proteins that are responsible for our ability to smell. And we have about 1,000 genes, or if you look at it in a different way, if we have 1,000 genes And we think that we have roughly about 20 to 30,000 genes in total. That means that it's about 3 to 5% of the entire genome is related to having genes to allow you to be able to smell. And it's the largest gene family that we have in vertebrates. When an odorant molecule binds, whatever it is, whether it's Axe body spray or it's that smell of pizza, whatever it is, those chemical molecules, those odorants that are dissolved in the air and then dissolved in the mucous membrane and then activate the receptor protein, it will activate a G protein coupled receptor, and the G protein that is associated with it is known as G ulf or G olfactory. Okay, and this in turn will cause the activation of adenylate cyclase. G-ulf activates adenylate cyclase, which then activates or increases the concentration of cyclic AMP. This is similar to what we saw in vision. So cyclic AMP can gate a cation channel. It then opens this channel. So now we have cyclic AMP. It opens the cation channel, and then it depolarizes the cell. So this cell can then depolarize, and it can travel, then action potential can get generated, and then it can travel all the way up into the olfactory bulb, and it may activate these mitral cells that you see up here, which form the olfactory tract. Do you guys have any questions about the anatomy of the circuit before we go on, or do you have any questions related to the sense of smell or the genes associated with the sense of smell? No? So we're going to talk about the events that go on down here. So when you have smell transduction, so a chemical binds, a chemical odorant binds to the receptor, whatever it is, we have so many of these different genes and we have so many of potential receptors for these different odorants, it will activate that G protein or G ulf. This G ulf in turn activates adenylate cyclase, increases cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP actually has the function of opening up the cation channel. The major cations that can flow through are both sodium as well as calcium. There is a fundamental difference though. So when things start, this sodium influx actually causes the major depolarization, and it causes the axon to fire and send an action potential up into the olfactory bulb. The calcium influx, though, seems to be more important if you have a lot of odorant around. So again, I hate to keep picking on Axe body spray. It's not that I hate Axe. I just happened to have visited my my daughter's high school the other week, and I was walking through the high school halls, and the guys during their break would be sitting in front of their lockers spraying Axe body spray all over themselves. I have no idea. Like, not sure if that is something that's common to all high schools or it's just her high school that does that. I just found it ridiculous. So I walked through this huge cloud of Axe body spray. After a while, I can't smell a single thing. I have adapted to this huge cloud, literally a cloud of Axe sitting around me, and it's because in my olfactory system, at the level of the receptor, I'm getting more calcium influx. The more odorants there are, the more likelihood that there is going to be the calcium flowing through this cation channel, and this will eventually lead to olfactory adaptation. And this olfactory adaptation means that there's going to be a decrease in the effectiveness of G-ulf to open up more more of the cation channels, and after a while, it's not going to perceptually make any difference to you. You won't even know that that smell is around anymore. So again, this is sort of shown in a slightly different way. When an odorant binds to one of the many different G proteins that recognize many, many different odorants, we have a huge family of G protein coupled receptors that can respond. It activates this G ulf. This activated G-ulf protein will then activate adenylate cyclase. Adenylate cyclase will then form more and more of the cyclic AMP on that particular sensory cell that will then open up sodium and calcium, allowing it to flow through this cyclic AMP gated channel, and this will cause depolarization. And if it reaches threshold, this cell will then fire an action potential that travels back through the cribriform plate up into the olfactory bulb. Do you have any questions about this before we go on? Yes. In this particular case, they're going to fire an action potential, the sensory cell that's involved.
So that's considered the primary thing?
Yeah, this is an example of a bipolar cell. So it has one process going down toward where it's going to bind the odorants, another one that is sending a projection up toward the mitral cells in the olfactory bulb. Okay, so going back to some of the specificity, in theory, we can distinguish between about 10,000 different odors. Again, in theory, in practice, we really don't have that luxury of being able to detect that many different types of odors. Even though I told you that we have thousands of these potential genes that make up 3 to 5% of the entire genome, the reality is we only have about 400 active genes being expressed, creating unique G protein coupled receptors, the ones that I just showed you here, unique ones here, about 400 of these that will encode for a particular odorant. And a protein can actually respond to more than one odor. It's not that specific. So a protein that is formed from one of those genes may bind and be activated by odorant A, but it could also be activated by odorant B. Okay, so there are other types of receptors as well, pain and temperature receptors, and I'll come back to this in a few moments. So when we start talking about the processing of this signal, an odorant binds, it's a chemical signal. It generates depolarization and an action potential goes back up into the olfactory bulb. How does your body actually decode this, or how does your brain actually decode what's going on here? All of the cells that have the receptor that has bound that odorant will signal to the same mitral cell within the olfactory bulb, and they will converge on a very select number of these secondary neurons in the olfactory bulb, and these are the mitral cells that I'll be showing you in a moment. And the brain starts to get all this information from those mitral cells to try to determine what types of smells it is encountering. So those olfactory receptor cells make synapses with those mitral cells in the olfactory bulb, and then these axons from the same receptor type, the same sensory receptor types, will all converge on a given mitral cell glomerulus. Before you ask what a glomerulus is, and I have to apologize, if you are looking here, this would represent a glomerulus. It's sort of like the axonal, the dendritic tree, and we call it a glomerulus or a grouping here in the olfactory bulb. So all of the ones that detected odorant A would be working their way to this particular glomerulus of this particular mitral cell. A different odorant might be going to this particular mitral cell over here. They all converge on the same mitral cell glomerulus, in other words. Okay, so they're all converging on the same sort of glomerulus on that mitral cell. And these mitral cells therefore receive input from all the same cells that have responded. They are amplifying that signal. So you've received information that this receptor is activated and the same receptor is activated in this part of the nasal cavity. All of that is encoded together by these mitral cells. And these mitral cells will then relay this information back into the olfactory cortex. Some of that information, though, gets refined. You can actually inhibit some of the glomeruli. And again, we won't have time to go into this in a lot of detail. But there are other cell types called these amacrine granule cells. And I mentioned amacrine cells in the visual system. There are amacrine granule cells in the olfactory system. And one of the things that they do is to release the neurotransmitter GABA. And they can actually turn off entire mitral cells. So again, this is another way to make sure that only the signals that we want to get into the nervous system, the ones that have the highest rate of excitation, the ones that have the strongest signal, the highest excitation, are the ones that actually get into the nervous system. So once those impulses make it past that amacrine cell, they're going to travel along the olfactory tract into the olfactory cortex, and I'll show you this in the next few slides. And different regions of the olfactory cortex are going to interpret and identify the types of smells that they're encountering. Some of that information also gets sent to the hypothalamus, the amygdala, and other parts of the limbic system, and this is for emotional sort of responses to odor. So you might have an emotional response, for example, to the smell of bread. Like maybe you equate the smell of bread or the smell of baking cookies to things like at Christmas time, and maybe you think about your family. And these types of emotional responses elicited by smell or previous experiences with that same smell occur because some of that information gets sent to the amygdala and the limbic system, which controls your emotional response. So again, going into some more detail, and the only extra detail that I'm going to add, because we've already talked about the thalamus being bypassed, is that when we talk about these olfactory areas, in the olfactory cortex that's buried deep within the brain, and it's a structure that's not easily accessible, the lateral portion of the olfactory cortex that only decodes information coming from the olfactory system, the olfactory neurons, is involved in the conscious perception of smell. And then the medial region, the one that's closer to the midline in the olfactory cortex, is involved in those emotional reactions to odors, again, along with the limbic cortex, the amygdala, and the hypothalamus. This area is also turned on by emotional responses to the same types of smell. At the very outset, I told you that we are reasonably sure that we can't detect pheromones. Pheromones are sort of released by certain animal species that allow them to know when it's time to mate, when there are different cues or signals that might be required. And we don't really have a structure that's known as the vironasal organ. Rodents have this, and it's involved in detecting pheromones. We don't have these types of structures, therefore we don't think that we can detect pheromones, and we don't have a clear amount of evidence that can actually suggest that human pheromones actually exist. So we can't detect the chemical, the odorant that might be involved, nor do we have the accessory structure, the vomeronasal organ that might be involved in the detection of these different pheromones. So this is a question I asked you before. How many cranial nerves do we have? 12. But it turns out that we actually have 13. It was actually, you think that anatomy is a dead science, but about 5 years ago, a number of anatomists actually started to go back and review the anatomy and the dissections that were done a decade to 100 years before. And one of the things that was clear in the records going back many, many, many years and even centuries is that in theory, there is a remnant of what is known as cranial nerve zero. So we start off with cranial nerve number one. Cranial nerve number one is the olfactory system. That's the one we've just been talking about. The olfactory bulb that we've been talking about is cranial nerve number one, this large structure that we've seen in profile. But when you do the dissection very carefully, there is a remnant that looks an awful like, a lot like a neuron, and this is what anatomists call cranial nerve zero. There's no function to cranial nerve zero. It is a vestigial remnant, as far as we can tell, but it seems to be in every species that you can do anatomy on and look at the gross anatomy of the brain. So again, we don't really know if we had in the past the capacity to detect pheromones. We don't have a vomeronasal organ, but we do have the remnants of the nerve that might have been responsible for its detection. So I'm going to change gears just a little bit, talk to you about the other chemoreceptive sense, which is taste. And if we talk about taste, we're talking about these taste buds. So this would be representative of one taste bud. This whole structure that you see that is being stained is one taste bud. And within this taste bud, you might have anywhere from 50 to 150 different taste cells. So this would be the nucleus of one taste cell. This would be the nucleus of another taste cell nearby. And this would be another taste cell. There are support cells around the side. And just like with the sense of smell, we also have regenerative stem cells that will allow for the regeneration of these taste cells as well. So if you burn your tongue, for example, you can't taste things for a while, they have the capacity to be able to regenerate these taste cells within this taste bud. Again, I'm not going to go into this in a lot of detail. I don't need you to memorize the different types of these taste buds. They're all named by the shape that they have. There are things like the foliate type of taste bud. There are other papillae-like taste buds as well, but I'm not going to ask you to know those. The more important thing is, how do we actually transduce a chemical signal from something that you are dissolving in your mouth into something that can be translated by the brain as a taste, right? It's really complex. It's not as trivial as it sounds. And if we take a look at each of these different taste cells that have these taste hairs that allow for the molecule to be swept closer to the taste pore, so you want to have as many cells detecting this as possible, then you can see that some of these cells have vesicular-like structures that might lead to the release of neurotransmitter. So we have at least five sensations, and I say at least five because it's still somewhat controversial. So they're always coming up with new taste sensations or taste senses. So the ones that we currently know of are things that detect sweet, the sense of sour, salty, bitter, as well as umami. So most of those are ones that you have heard of before. Some of you who have taken psychology courses will have heard of umami. And what is umami? Savory. Okay, what does savory actually mean? Like you just told me, and it's completely right, savory. What is savory though? Yes. Meaty? A meaty kind of flavor. I can tell you what sweet is, right? And I can even give you an example of sweet. I can even give you an example of salty. Give me an example of umami. Grandma's food. Okay, I don't know your grandma, so I can't comment. Any specific food that you can relate? Something fatty? Maybe. There's a lot of there's a lot of debate as to whether or not the tongue also has receptors on taste cells that can detect long chain fatty acids. Again, a lot of debate about this. Anything else? Chicken broth. Okay, you're getting a little closer. Chicken broth, pepperoni. Those would be like savory foods. Cheeses would be like savory foods. And anything that contains MSG, or monosodium glutamate, is also something that would elicit responses from umami, which is why you see sugars and glutamate. And glutamate is responding to activating the umami receptor type. So it turns out that the model that you probably learned about in high school, where you have like different regions of your tongue responding best to sweet, etc., is not right, because we have these receptors scattered throughout. We have areas that have higher concentrations of some receptor types than others in the taste buds. But overall, it's actually not as simple as we once thought it was. So these different taste cells that you are seeing here, and these are all polarized epithelial cells, they're all derived from epithelial cells. Neurons are derived from epithelial cells, and it makes sense that these taste cells are derived from epithelial cells. So we have tight junctions at the top. We don't want the taste end to be going in between the gaps. We want it to be directly activating these cells at the very top, so we see these tight junctions. And if we were to take a look at one of those different taste buds with all of those different cells, 50 to 150 of these different cells, we might see a mixture of these different types of cells within them. So we might start to see these type 1 cells or the type 1 support cells. These are the ones that are likely going to detect when you're eating something salty. We might also see some of these type 2 receptor cells that have G protein coupled receptors that respond when you eat something sweet, or if you eat something bitter, or if you eat something that contains something savory or something that has MSG and that activates umami. And then we have this type 3, and this type 3 again is really controversial as well. Even though we've known about this taste for a very long time, scientists still can't really come to a consensus where everyone in the whole world agrees that this is the way that the sense of sour works and how we actually transduce this sense of sour. It might involve the release of serotonin onto the neurons that you see here, and these other ones will release ATP. So these type 2s, the sweet, bitter, umami, will release ATP onto these neurons that you see down here. Okay, so again, this is sort of a hodgepodge of different cell types. Generally, one cell will taste just or sense one taste, but you can have in a taste bud many of these different types of cells. And we're going to go through each of these in turn. I'm going to ask you to make sure that you know the mechanisms associated with each of the senses of taste. So please make sure that the next few slides, if you can pay a little bit more attention to them or jot down some notes to come back and chat about them later, it probably would be a really good idea. So again, most of this is for your own information. I'm going to tell you the mechanism, which is the most important parts of these upcoming slides. So the most sensitive sort of sour detectors, taste buds, are found on the lateral or the side parts of your tongue. It's not exactly like the type of map that you learned about in high school where you dropped on like different tastes onto different areas of the tongue and tried to detect them. So it's a little different than what we traditionally learned. Salty are generally found clustered more at the very front of your tongue, on the tip of your tongue. It has the lowest sensitivity. It is not activated by sweet at all. Like sweet and sour, actually they're completely different tastes. One chemical does not activate the other at all. Things that contain sodium will cause salty taste receptors to be activated and cause them to be depolarized, but so will other metal ions. If you ever stick something in your mouth and it tastes like metal, you can taste that metal because of the salty receptor types. And bitter are the most sensitive of all of the receptors that you have on your tongue. They're the most sensitive out of all of the different classes. And one of the things that we think they're there for is so that if you ingest a plant, so plants have, certain plants have alkaloids. Alkaloids generally are poisonous to us, right? And you need to be able to detect that before you actually ingest it. And so you have this capacity at the back of your tongue to detect anything just before you swallow it to be able to spit it out. So these plant alkaloids are really that we find a lot in nature and that are generally poisonous to us. Although you eat plant alkaloids all the time and you ingest plant alkaloids all the time. Can you, by the way, can you give me an example of a plant alkaloid that most of you ingest? Caffeine. So caffeine is a plant alkaloid. When you're drinking coffee or tea, if you are not putting in a ton of cream or sugar, coffee is bitter. So is tea. Tea itself is bitter, and that's the alkaloid part of the caffeine that you're actually tasting. Okay, so sweet, again, on the tip of the tongue, lowest sensitivity with salt, as I've just showed you. It doesn't, by the way, only have to be sugar. It could be other carbohydrates, some proteins, some amino acids. Artificial sweeteners will also activate the sweet receptors, or any sweetener will activate these these particular receptors. And then the last part, the umami, which is activated by glutamate or monosodium glutamate. So when you have savory cooking, usually you toss in things that increase the glutamate concentration in your food. And this has sort of a scattered sensitivity across the tongue. And it's really the amino acids that are being broken down to glutamate that allow you to be able to taste things as savory. So again, the sweet and umami involve these type 1 receptors. The bitter involves these type 2 receptors. These receptor proteins are usually associated with a G protein called gustusin. You often might hear about the gustatory pathway, the taste pathway, and this is where gustusin comes from. And this is that signal transduction pathway. These pathways increase intracellular calcium, eventually causing the release of ATP. But before calcium comes in, there are a number of upstream pathways. So this is a pretty good slide for you to go back and review to make sure that you understand how these different tastants work. So when we're talking about sweet, if we have a sweet molecule, either sugar, an amino acid, an artificial sweetener, it binds to the G protein, it activates gustusin, it will activate adenylate cyclase and increase cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP, in turn, will activate a kinase that will phosphorylate this potassium channel, and this potassium channel then closes, and as potassium channels close, this cell depolarizes. If the cell depolarizes, it will activate voltage-dependent calcium channels, allowing calcium to come in and then causing neurotransmitters like ATP to be released. The bitter tastant is a little different. The gustusin breaks apart. The alpha subunit will then work on breaking down lipid membranes into diacyl glycerol, IP3. This will release, the IP3 helps to release calcium from intracellular stores. We don't need depolarization here. The intracellular calcium is enough to activate and cause the release of ATP through membrane fusion events. So this will bypass sort of the depolarization. We don't have a channel that's associated with it. Glutamate is, again, very similar. It will help to activate adenylate cyclase, more cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP in this case opens up a calcium channel. Calcium comes in. Calcium influx causes depolarization of this cell, activates voltage-dependent calcium channels, and causes ATP from neurotransmitter vesicles to be released onto the gustatory neuron. Questions about any of those mechanisms before we go on, because we only have two more tastants left, and I'm hoping that the G protein ones, you'll have time to go back, review, make sure that it's clear for you in terms of how it works. Any questions at all? So if we're looking at salty and sour, salt makes sense. If you're eating something salty, it has lots of sodium chloride. The increased amount of sodium will enter through these type 1 cells. It looks an awful lot like an ENaC or an epithelial sodium channel. It's often abbreviated as ENaC. And this depolarizes the cell. Sour is very controversial, as I mentioned. There are lots of different theories about how sour tastes are actually decoded. It involves having hydrogen ions. So anything that is sour, think of lemons, for example, there's a high acid content. The acid usually has lots of hydrogen ions associated with it. But how those hydrogen ions actually produce depolarization is really anyone's guess. There are a number of theories. It could be hydrogen works on the outside of the cell, hydrogen goes inside the cell first, then it causes things to happen. We're not really sure. The theory that I'm going to show you here is mainly related to how hydrogen works on the outside, but there's no, there's nothing to stop it from working from the inside surface or the intracellular. So again, hydrogen ions from acid-containing food can cause depolarization by any of these mechanisms. We're not sure which one dominates or if we have more than one of these mechanisms. Hydrogen could simply enter the cell directly through a hydrogen channel, definitely been detected in these cell types. It could also bind once it's in, it can also bind to these potassium channels, and it can close these potassium channels as well, closing this gate, preventing any potassium from leaving the cell, and as a result of this, causing depolarization. It could also cause the opening of other ligand-gated channels by binding to the outside and allowing other positive ions to come through. All three mechanisms cause an increase of positive charge inside the cell. All of those mechanisms cause depolarization. We don't know which one it is. I'm going to ask you to make sure that you go back and review all of those different mechanisms for when we did like sour. Do you have any questions about any of those five tastings? You're all good? Kind of good? Okay, so again, we won't go into this in a lot of detail. You have nerve endings in your mouth through these transient receptor potentials receptors, and this can be activated by substances that you like eating, things like capsaicin. If you're eating hot, spicy food, hot spicy food has capsaicin in it. It activates capsaicin nerve endings, that pain and nerve endings in your mouth. Menthol is another of these transient receptor potential receptors. And again, it's a very different sensation as well. Your stomach and intestines can sense food chemistry as well, we think. You can actually detect what you're actually eating, specifically for things like sweet, umami. It can activate things through a gustusin-like mechanism. So you have these receptors in a number of places. And you guys are all good with these different taste pathways, right? All good? Yeah? So are you sure you're all good? Not so sure? Shall we give it a shot now? Should we try it? Not too early? Too soon? Too soon? Not too soon? Way too soon? It's never way too soon. We're physiologists. It's never way too soon for physiologists. Can I have seven volunteers? Yeah, just come on up. It's not food. I don't know why they make the assumption that this is food. So I'm not really great at math, but as far as I can tell, this is not seven. Okay. So we only have five tastes. Types of taste. I'll omit sort of the long chain fatty acids. So there are probably some other things that you need to think about as well. So I'm going to ask all of you to pick one of these envelopes. Now we have eight. Okay. So maybe I'll ask you to start from, what is this, the right, work our way over to the left. Maybe you can open up your little packet.
Food.
You have food, okay. So, all right. So, what taste is that? You have no idea. Okay. Can you guys help him? What do you think this is? Salty. Okay, so how are you going to activate your taste receptor? Can anyone help your colleague out? Sodium ions will flow through, causing depolarization. Thank you for playing. Thank you. No, you keep it. Thanks. All right. So, what do you have? Twix. Sweet. And so, what sort of pathway would cause the activation of this the receptors that would be detecting that?
The sweet will cause a neurotransmitter to.
Okay, let's help him out before he goes any further. So what is the mechanism? It's a G protein coupled mechanism. What's going to happen? So sweet whatever it is, sugar or whatever artificial sweetener it is, will bind, activate gustusin. Then what happens? Sorry? So calcium influx. Okay. So anyone want to help your colleague? Sorry?
ATP.
Sorry?
It's like ATP.
ATP will eventually get released. Yes, correct. All right. Well, I'll save him from any more struggling up here and allow him to enjoy his Twix. Thank you very much. And what do you have there?
So I have a shin cup.
You have a shin cup?
Yeah.
Okay.
I want to say it's salty. I'm going to say it's salty.
maybe. But one of the things that you find a lot of in that, I don't know if you eat, I thought students actually ate lots of noodles. Yeah, you get a lot of MSG in this. So what would MSG activate?
Umami.
Yes, nice. Yeah. And hopefully by the time Tuesday rolls around, you'll know like how that umami pathway will work. All right, thank you for playing. Awesome, thanks.
Spicy, I think, or salty, or umami, I don't know.
So your colleague is probably looking at a number of different tastes. This is jalapeno, so this would be sort of the spicy. And what sort of receptor system would that be working on?
It has that molecule capsaicin.
So capsaicin, which is acting on what sort of
type? It's with the ATP.
So these TRP receptors. Yes, of course. Okay, all right, thank you.
I don't know the mechanism.
You don't know the mechanism, and I actually didn't go into the mechanism. No, actually, you have to read the, there's a piece of paper inside there. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. So it's U of T being somewhat bitter, right? So if you're here at U of T, at some point you experience some bitterness. But in addition to that, she also has a card for coffee. So this is sort of the bitter pathway. You have?
I have sour.
So sour pathway that's involved in sour. Can anyone help your colleague out? Sorry? Ion channels? Many of the three different types of ions. And what do you have?
Tic Tacs.
Okay, awesome. And what's good? I think it's menthol.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And that would be a TRP. All right, thanks for volunteering. So one of the reasons why I did that was so that you would have a chance to go back and review for Tuesday some of the different pathways, the biochemical pathways that are involved in different types of taste sensations. So I'm going to ask you to know even things like this related to that are not normally associated with the five tastes that we normally have, but in addition, things that might activate through transient receptor potentials, whether it's menthol, whether it's capsaicin and really spicy food. I'm hoping that you'll go back because I think you have this implicit understanding that it's important that you do understand the mechanisms, and I hope that you'll spend some time going through it. So this taste pathway, again, travels through a number of different nerves once they send their gustatory axons back. So whether it's activated by ATP, activated by serotonin, whatever it is, they will make synapses onto the medulla before going up to the thalamus. This is, again, another taste, another sensation that goes up to the thalamus. And eventually, it will go into the gustatory cortex that you see right here. And again, I don't need you to worry about all the different cranial nerves, like the facial nerve or any of the other nerves that are involved, like the vagus, in this pathway. Just to give you an idea of how these things travel from where they're found in the gustatory pathway, when you're detecting all of these things in your tongue and on the roof of your mouth, and that previous slide is really an encapsulation of what you're seeing here, all of these different nerve fibers will send their projections up into the medulla. They will make a synapse onto a group of neurons called the solitary nucleus in the medulla. They will then send their projections up into the gustatory cortex past the thalamus. And again, I told you that every sense has its own sort of neighborhood within the thalamus. And we talked about the lateral geniculate for vision and for the sense of taste, we have a specific group, the ventral posterior medial nucleus within the thalamus, that is only there to relay information about taste coming in through the receptors on your tongue. And eventually it will get into the gustatory cortex up in this region of the brain known as the insula. So when you have that sense of disgust, or when you've tasted something really, really bad and you make that, ew, I can't believe I tasted that, it's the insula that's actually signaling that sense of disgust and everything else. That's the gustatory cortex up in your brain. Just one last slide and then we'll sort of take a break. It may seem like really trivial, but I told you that the nervous system actually gives us a lot of information. I told you about the back of the retina. So it's really important as an early sign for neurodegeneration. It's also an early sign for things like stroke. You can actually see clots forming at the back of your eye before they reach your brain. So having knowledge of the nervous system and the senses is actually really important. There are some olfactory disorders that develop, things like anosmia. So you can't smell anymore for whatever reasons. You might be on chemotherapy. So that's very, very common. Chemotherapy kills off dividing cells, including the cells that divide in the olfactory cortex. It might be the result of head injuries, or it could be a precursor for Parkinson's. We now know that, in fact, anosmias, or your inability to detect odor, specific odors, is actually a predecessor or precursor as a diagnostic test for some different neurodegenerative conditions. Do you know what sense of smell is associated with Alzheimer's disease? Any guesses? So the first thing that seems to disappear from someone's memory, because we're all somewhat familiar with peanut butter. If you can't smell peanut butter anymore and you have an anosmia for peanut butter, that's a sign that there's serious degeneration going on in your brain. We also know that uncinate fits. The uncus is a region of your brain that is involved in olfaction, your sense of smell. And in certain individuals, right before they have a seizure, they will actually start smelling different things. And this aura, this uncinate hallucination or aura that is really common, is because this area of the brain is being sort of activated, and you smell things even though there's no odor in the room. Like, you might smell like, yeah, I smell like bacon and eggs. Is someone cooking that just before they have a seizure? Taste problems tend to be a little less common. It could result from infections. You could have a head injury. Certain chemicals will destroy your taste buds for long periods of time. Medications are often a cause for the loss of your sense of taste. If you're having radiation for cancer of the head or neck, that can also lead to your loss of taste over time as well. So I think now is a good time to take a break. Maybe hit up some of your colleagues that have some snacks available for you during the break. They seem to have a lot, so maybe do that, and we'll finish off with the last few senses.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, folks, if you don't mind. I'm not sure the Raptors are going to be able to win unless I'm home watching them, so I want to make sure I give them every chance to win. I'm sure it's the same for all of you, right? So let's get going. Yes, let's go Raptors. Nice. Since we're talking about hearing, that's great. So we're going to be talking about two different things. And in order for us to be able to understand both things, both equilibrium, your sense of balance, how you know like where your head and your body is in space, but particularly like where your head is in space, you need to be able to understand the different aspects of the ear. And I have to take you through both parts. So your hearing and your sense of balance is related to the ear, which is why we're going to go through the anatomy of the ear really quickly. We'll talk about equilibrium. And along the way, we're going to talk about these hair cells. Hair cells within the ear are involved in both your sense of hearing as well as your sense of balance. We're not going to concentrate on the physics of sound waves. I want you to be concentrating more on how a signal, vibration of the air. So I'm talking, the air is vibrating. That vibrating is vibrating against your eardrum. How does that get transduced into action potentials that your brain understands? So in order for us to get into all of these different sections, we need to understand a few things about the anatomy of the ear and some of the different parts of the ear that actually allow us to do both things, both the sense of balance as well as allowing us to be able to hear. The vast majority of what I'm going to be talking to you about occurs within the inner ear. We don't really talk about this middle ear at all. And this middle ear is everything from the eardrum and these three small bones, the malleus, incus, and stapes, that then push against this structure known as the cochlea. But when we're starting, before we get into hearing and the cochlea, which is what you're seeing here, we have to talk about this vestibular apparatus, the other parts of the inner ear. So everything here is part of the inner ear. And this inner ear is really important because it has this vestibular apparatus for your sense of balance, as well as the cochlea for hearing. So in terms of equilibrium, in order for us to understand it, we have to understand that there are a number of different structures within the inner ear that are there and in place to make sure that your head is in an upright position. So we need to be able to see how our head is sort of in an X, Y, and Z plane. And we need to have detectors that can see if there's any rotation or tilting off of this X, Y, and Z plane. So this idea of proprioception and why we can actually detect movement is going to be what I'm going to try getting through in the next couple of slides. So this vestibular apparatus actually is a easy to understand structure as long as you don't try to make it overly complicated. And this goes back to you by the end of this section for both hearing and for what I'm going to be telling you about in terms of balance. It all gets down to the hair cells. Within the inner ear, we detect hearing and we detect balance as a pressure put on hair cells within the cochlea or within the vestibular apparatus, which we are going to define as these semicircular canals. So here is one semicircular canal, here is another one, and here is a third, X, Y, and Z in space on one side of your head. The same thing mirrored on the other side of your head. So you can imagine like having like three different detectors plus these other ones that you see here, the utricle and the saccule, that allow you to know exactly where your head is in space all the time. And it's really important that you do. It's so important, for example, if you've gone home late after studying or after watching the Raptors game, once in a while you'll see someone who's really, really tired, right? And what do they start to do? They start nodding their head. What did they do after they start nodding their head? Sorry? They fall asleep. Okay, they may. They're on their way to falling asleep. But most of the time, because they're aware of like where their head is at, they'll snap it back up right before they eventually fall asleep. And that's because this vestibular apparatus is telling them, even when they're in a semi-conscious state, that your head is not at the proper orientation. It's actually too far down. You're going to fall over if you're not careful. And so these semicircular canals and the macula of the two otoliths organs, the otoliths meaning that they have another structure, and you'll understand that in a few moments, the utricle and the saccule are telling you about how your head is in space all the time. So in terms of the canals that we see here, these semicircular canals, all at 90 degrees to each other or orthogonal to each other, this tells you when you're like shaking your head no, like when you're moving your head in a no fashion, or if you're doing an up and down nodding, or you're tilting your head sort of side to side. These are the semicircular canals that are detecting how your head is doing that. The other utricle and saccule will also help in that. So when you're tilting your head, they also detect that. But these are there to tell you where your head is in space as well. So each of these canals is not empty. The entire structure in the inner ear is filled with fluid. The cochlea is filled with fluid. The semicircular canals are filled with fluid. Everything in the inner ear is filled with fluid. And this fluid is a very specialized fluid called the endolymph. And this endolymph is going to be important in a moment. And so you'll see this is the semicircular canal filled with fluid. There's this little bulge down here at the bottom, and this is the ampulla. And inside the ampulla, this is where we're going to find the hair cells that I kept mentioning over the last little while. But I want you to also think about what I just told you. This is in fluid, okay? So everything here is in fluid, including the cochlea. It's also in fluid, and we need to chat a little bit about that when we get to it a little bit later on. So this is that endolymph. This is the fluid. This is in that whole semicircular canal. We're at the very bottom of the semicircular canal, that little bulge that I talked about earlier, the ampulla. And this is sort of a blow up of the ampulla. So you'd have to imagine that the semicircular canal is going up in this massive circle up here, filled with this endolymph all the way through. And this is the structure at the very bottom of the ampulla, this little bulge here, and this membrane that sits down right in the middle that separates this part from this part, it's like having a curtain, is called the cupula. The hair cells that I've been mentioning are sitting right under the cupula. So the hair cells are going to be swept back and forth by this sheet that is known as the cupula. But then that gets to how do you move the cupula that's going to bend these hair cells? These hair cells, by the way, have very stiff cilia. They're short. They're microscopic. You can't see them with the naked eye. And these stereocilia are directly embedded and extend into this gelatinous mass, the curtain-like structure that we call the cupula. So when you turn your head, the fluid in this semicircular canal is going to move too. So every time you rotate your head, you know that your head is rotating because the fluid is also rotating. And when the fluid rotates, it pushes up in one direction or the other, depending on how you're rotating your head, to move and be pushed by the fluid that is surrounding it. So if you're moving it this way, the hair cells that are embedded with it are also going to be pushed in that particular direction. Okay, so the endolymph pushes on this cupula. The cupula then pushes on the hair cells as you rotate your head. Crystal clear, not so crystal clear. Need time to think a little bit about it. Okay, so let me give this to you in a slightly different way, and then we'll come back and chat. So no matter what we're talking about, when we're talking about hearing or your sense of balance in those semicircular canals, in your inner ear, we're really talking about these hair cells. These hair cells have these little stereocilia that you see up here at the top. So here's one stereocilia, here's another stereocilia, and here's the third. They have some polarity associated with them. In other words, they have directionality. It's like knowing the left side from the right side. And the reason why they have directionality is they are all pointed toward this longer stereocilium, which we call the kinocilium. This kinocilium is always the longest stereocilia that we have on this one side. And these stereocilia in theory, can be either moved toward this kinocilium or they could be moved away from that kinocilium. If you're looking very carefully at this, and I'm not sure it's on this diagram, but it is on the diagram for the hearing section, you have these small little blobs that you see in between the stereocilia. And these stereocilia blobs are known as tip links. And these tip links are proteins that act a lot like those slinkies. So they kind of stretch and then collapse, stretch and then collapse. And these tip links can bend along with the stereocilia. So remember, there's a cupula sitting on top of it, and that cupula moves back and forth depending on how you're rotating your head. And as it moves back and forth, some of the stereocilia are going to go back and forth as well. Now, why is all of this important? This is important because if these hairs are bending toward the kinocilium, the longest one, then this whole hair cell will depolarize because these tip links pull open channels that are associated with it. If they're bending in the right direction, the tip links open up a channel, and then it allows the ions to flow in, depolarizing this hair cell. If you are bending it in the other direction, because you can move your head this way and you can move your head the other way, if you're bending it away from the kinocilium, so the kinocilium is going this way, so are all the other stereocilia, then actually if it's bending away, this cell will hyperpolarize. So if you're moving it in one direction, it depolarizes. If you're moving in another, it hyperpolarizes. So it tells your semicircular canals some directionality. If you're moving it this way, you're excitable. If you're moving this way, you're turning yourself off. And this is important because at rest, where your head is just perfectly still, it's not moving, it's not rotating, these hair cells are tonically active. They're always releasing a little bit of this neurotransmitter saying where your head is located in space. So again, to not go into this in too much detail, and I'm not going to be asking you, because it's hard for me too, to be quite honest. I don't think it's fair to ask you a question where I would take a few minutes to actually sit down, work out. If I'm turning my head left, the fluid, the endolymph is moving the other way, it's pushing on the stereocilia this way. It's more important to understand the concept, so don't worry that I'm going to ask you if your head's rotating in this direction, what's happening to the endolymph, etc. But I'm hoping that you'll understand this general concept. The endolymph has inertia associated with it. Any fluid has inertia associated with it. That's why when you move your cup and there's fluid in it, it takes a few seconds for the liquid to actually move as the cup has already left. And then after a while, it settles down. And it's exactly the same thing. The endolymph, when you start turning your head, will actually have that same inertia. So if you're starting an acceleration, for example, there's this endolymph lag, and then after a while, if you're in a car, you'll know that you're accelerating, and after a while, when you're at the same speed all the time, you're not even aware that your car is moving unless you look outside or you hear the engine. But if you were not paying attention to those, then you wouldn't even know that you were still accelerating because your endolymph has sort of caught up. And again, I think that's the most important thing that I wanted to get across to you, that the fluid inside it has inertia associated with it, giving it a lag time. And this is reflected in the way in which you detect movement in your head. And that's the semicircular canals. They tell you about head tilting up, head tilting down, turning your head to the left, to the right, and then moving your head sort of side to side. All of that is the semicircular canals. Related to that are those two other structures, the utricle and the saccule, as part of this macula. Both of these structures are there because they have this otolith. And these otoliths are these small calcium carbonate deposits that sit together. They're heavy, relatively speaking, they're heavy. And so they push down on these little hair cells that you see here. And normally that's not an issue, because remember, hair cells have directionality. You can see this directionality really nicely in this particular diagram. What would we call this longest one right here? So that's the kinocilium. What would happen if, for example, the otolith started pushing on it and they started moving toward the kinocilium? What would happen to this hair cell? it would depolarize. And if I moved it the other way, it would hyperpolarize. Same idea, same principle. And so instead of using the saccule, that sort of membranous sheath, to move these hair cells back and forth, in the utricle and saccule, what happens is we have these otoliths that sit on top of the hair cells. And as you tilt your head back, not only are you exciting the semicircular canals, you'll also excite these or pull on these otoliths, and these otoliths will bend the hairs as well. So you can imagine, for example, if your head is upright and stationary, the hairs on the utricle, in this case, aren't bent. And if you start tilting your head back, some of those calcium carbonate crystals, because they have some mass and weight associated with them, they will pull back on the kinocilium and pull back on the stereocilia, opening them up and causing them to depolarize. If you do it the other way, it would hyperpolarize those particular hair cells. So these hair cells eventually will send their signals once they're activated through these nerves. So they release neurotransmitters, they activate and cause depolarization. Action potentials are sent down these nerves that eventually form cranial nerve number 8. These can then go either to the cerebellum. Your cerebellum, as we'll learn in the very last lecture I have with you, is important for your sense of balance and your sense of where your head is, where your joints are. It gives you fine motor movement control, and the cerebellum is where some of those different signals are going to be relayed, as well as into other areas of the cortex. So I'm going to go into hearing, and again, I think it's fair to tell you, because I want you to be using your time wisely. In this particular section as well, Dr. Key asked me to come up with 7 questions from this particular lecture. We have about 100 slides. I think I would rather you focus on things that I spent more time trying to get you to understand than things that I've just gone over really quickly. So the chemosensory systems, taste and smell, the biochemical pathways, things related to how hair cells work, and in hearing, those are things that I want you to spend time on. And again, hopefully you'll have some time over the weekend to do this. I ask you to think a little bit about what's happening. So we hear sound because air vibrates. So when I talk, the air is kind of vibrating and then it's hitting your ear. But that's all through air. The inner part of your ear, which contains the cochlea, this part here, is actually filled with fluid. It's filled with that endolymph that I told you about earlier. So are the semicircular canals and everything else. In order for you to be able to take the movement of air pushing up against your eardrum, so your eardrum is vibrating at exactly the same frequency as my voice right now, as it does so, it has to move these really small bones called the malleus, incus, and stapes, which pull together in a lever system to actually move another membrane here called the round window. And this particular structure actually will move the fluid that is inside the cochlea. So think about that. Why do we need these small bones? We need these small bones because moving air is easy. You move through air all the time. Sound moves through air really easily. But in order for you to be able to move things in fluid, you have to amplify the signal, which is what these three little bones are doing. And they amplify it up to 22 times the amplitude that you normally hear. So again, I'm not going to concentrate on the physics of sound. It's all about pressure waves, about how we hear. These pressure waves hit the eardrum that I just showed you. And we can associate this compression and expansion of air, the vibration of air, as both a wavelength as well as a frequency. Not so important. Again, if you're really interested in it, we have frequency we determine as pitch. If you have like a really high pitched, really high voice, then you have a really high frequency. If you have a low pitched voice, you have a low frequency voice. It's related to the overall frequency. It is important though to note a couple of things. So when you're born and when you're a newborn, you have really, really good hearing, like outstanding hearing. Your hearing range is on the order of 20 to 20,000 hertz. your babies can hear things that we can't. Over time, even if you're not sort of using earphones and everything else, our hearing range actually shrinks. And I think most of you are aware that, especially as you get older, your hearing starts to get worse and worse. Your parents probably might start losing their hearing just a little bit as they get older. Most of the time, we're not hearing things in the 20 hertz range. We're not hearing the really, really high-pitched sounds in the 20,000 hertz range. And what we're hearing most of the time, day-to-day, in your interaction with your friends, on TV and everything else, is really in the 1,000 to 3,000 hertz range. And again, we're not really conscious that we're losing the ability to hear these other frequencies. Again, one other thing to make note of is amplitude, the loudness. So a frequency is whether you're speaking really with a high pitch or a low pitch. Amplitude is related to how loud you're speaking. So if you're speaking softly, you have low amplitude. If you're speaking loudly, it's a high amplitude. And again, that's for your own information as well. High decibels over time, 80 decibels, can actually damage hearing. And this is, again, something we'll talk about really briefly when we get into the section on hearing. So this this sort of compression of air that we hear as sound hits the eardrum starts vibrating at exactly the same frequency as the air sound is vibrating. It then causes the vibration of these malleus, incus, and stapes bones, and then they will magnify this sound even more so that they will be pushing up against this and I think I told you round window. The round window is down here. I have to apologize. The oval window, to move the fluid in the cochlea at exactly the same frequency. Fluid is really hard to move. Air is really easy to move. And therefore, we need these three bones. But that still doesn't tell us how sound gets detected, nor how we can actually make sense of these vibrations in the air. So a couple of things to make note of. So these waves travel through the fluid within the cochlea. So this is the cochlea, and we sort of have unwound the cochlea. So this oval window vibrates, the fluid inside vibrates, it sets up fluid waves, and it's moving this cochlear, the perilymph, and then we'll talk about this endolymph again in a few seconds. Eventually, what we're going to talk about is what is happening right here. So we haven't talked about any hair cells yet. Where are these hair cells that I've been talking to you about? If we were to take a look at the cochlea, so that cochlea is normally a structure that is wound up like this. If we were to take the cochlea and we were to unwind the cochlea, there's a couple of things that I want you to make note of. So this end down here is the end that we're going to call the one that's closest to the eardrum. We're going to call it closest to the oval window. And then there's the other end, the end that we have unwound, which is called the helicotrema. And you'll understand why we need to know what part of this cochlea we're on. And we have all of these different ducts. We have a vestibular duct full of fluid, we have a cochlear duct full of fluid, and then we have a tympanic duct full of fluid. So we have perilymph up here, perilymph down here, and then this endolymph in the middle. Okay, so all of these are a little bit different. All of these, and especially the cochlear duct down here, which we sometimes call the scalum media, has this endolymph. So this is really different, and I want you to make note of this. This endolymph, just like we saw earlier with the other system, has a lot of potassium outside, a little sodium. Is that what we normally encounter in the nervous system? So think about the extracellular fluid that you learned about with Dr. Key. Do we have lots of potassium outside and little sodium outside? It's usually the reverse. So keep this in mind when we're talking about depolarization in a moment. So this is sort of the cochlea. This is that structure that we see right in the middle within this structure here called the cochlear duct. This is that cochlear duct that you're seeing. And if you're looking really carefully, and I'll show you this in the next diagram, this whole structure is known as the organ of Corti. And this organ of Corti is organized like this. This organ of Corti has this these hair cells that you see here, you can see that they're organized exactly the same way as we saw earlier with the vestibular apparatus. They're sitting on top of what is known as the basilar membrane, and on top of them, they have another membrane called the tectorial membrane. Okay, is that clear for everyone? We also have three rows and one row. So we have three rows of these outer hair cells, and then we have this one row of these inner hair cells, and I'll talk about those really briefly. Is that okay for everyone? Okay, so up until now, just to see how well you've retained this information, up until now, when we talk about hair cells, how have we opened up these hair cells? How have we bent the stereocilia? What mechanisms have we seen? Calcium carbonate, those otoliths, as they slide, they can pull these tip links open. That's one way. What's the other way? So the fluid pushes against what? The cupula. The cupula has that gelatinous membrane, so we can pull things open, we can slide things. So take a look at how this is organized. Here are those hair cells. Here are the ways in which they are in contact with this tectorial membrane. So maybe you can start to envision, if we have looked at the otoliths and how they slide back and open up the stereocilia, maybe you can start to imagine how movement against this tectorial membrane might actually open up some of these different stereocilia. So when these waves of sound come in and they pass through this cochlear duct, what they're going to do is they're going to cause this basilar membrane to also vibrate. Remember, there's movement of the fluid and there's going to be movement and vibration of this basilar membrane. As this basilar membrane starts to vibrate up and down, it's going to start pushing these hair cells up and down. They have nowhere to go because right on top of them, they have this tectorial membrane, which pulls open some of those different cilia that we are going to look at. So at rest, just like we saw with the vestibular system, when your head was perfectly still, your vestibular system, the semicircular canals, they had some tonic activity. It's exactly the same here when you are looking at the cochlea and you're looking at the hair cells, there is this low-grade activity that you see here, and these tip links, these protein bridges that you see here, can open and close these channels that are associated with the cilia membrane. At rest, about 10% of these channels are open at any time. Now, imagine a sound wave has worked its way in through the oval window. It's passing through the cochlear duct. As it's going through and pushing the fluid in the cochlear duct, it's causing that basilar membrane on which the hair cells are sitting to like be vibrating up and down at exactly the same frequency as the air is outside of it. As it vibrates up and down, it's pushing on this tectorial membrane, and as it does so, it will cause this to, start opening and bending toward this largest cilium. And again, we can just call it the kinocilium. This allows cations to flow in through those open channels. Because the endolymph is potassium rich, we have potassium flowing through. This is one of the rare instances in the nervous system where potassium influx moving into the cell actually causes depolarization. Usually we think about sodium moving in or potassium leaving, but here potassium coming in causes depolarization. And as it depolarizes, it will open up voltage-dependent channels. The voltage-dependent channels cause calcium to flow in. Calcium then causes neurotransmitter vesicles to fuse, and the neurotransmitters get released, causing the auditory nerve to be excited. So if the cilia tends to bend away, it can actually cause the closing of these channels, and then none of the vesicles get released at all. Okay, so exactly like we saw with the vestibular system. So how does that actually relate to sound? Well, I told you that all of these different hair cells are sitting on this basilar membrane, and here we're only looking at the basilar membrane. And this basilar membrane itself has some unique properties associated with it. The basilar membrane actually is a frequency map. It's mapping specific frequencies depending on where the sound is coming in. So near the round window or oval window, same idea, same place, at the very beginning, near the eardrum, the fibers of the basilar membrane are really, really stiff. In order for you to get them to start vibrating, you need them to have like really, really high frequency for it to start moving. So it's very stiff here, but it's very, very flexible near the helicotrema end. And that means that any hair cells that are found here are going to be detecting low frequencies, and any hair cells that are found up here are going to be responding best to the high frequencies. And so along the entire length, we have different rows of hair cells that are going to be responding to different frequencies as they start working their way down this particular basilar membrane. So high frequencies will work best up here, low frequencies will activate hair cells all the way down here. And this is the way that sound actually travels. So if you look at the membrane motion, the overall way in which it vibrates, at 100 hertz near the helicotrema end, we would see lots and lots of movement. The membrane starts moving a lot at the very end. At higher frequencies, we can see that it's shifting more toward the round window or oval window. And at the very highest frequencies, it's moving even closer to the oval window. Okay, so the basilar membrane does indeed vibrate at very, very specific sound frequencies. And the hair cells that are found on them will therefore be associated with that particular frequency. Do you have any questions on this before we go on? Can I ask you a different question? So what do you think happens when you hear sound for either a very, very long period of time or something is really, really loud? So some of you might know, like if you're standing beside a cannon as it shoots off and it's like a really loud clap, you'll be deaf for a while, right? Or some of you have gone to a concert. I told you the really high 120 decibels is enough to damage hearing. You might not hear. What happens when your hearing starts to come back? I know some of you have gone to these types of concerts. What happens? No judgment. By the way, your ears ring, exactly. So when your ears are ringing, what does that actually represent?
Adaptation.
Adaptation to what? And why do you have ringing? Like it makes sense that I can't hear anything for a while, but when my hearing returns and when I can start hearing things, all I hear is like ringing in my ears. Why do I hear that? What do you think happens like if it's a low frequency sound? The basilar membrane kind of moves up and down at specific frequencies, right? We all agree on that. What do you think happens when the amplitude, the loudness of a sound goes up at exactly the same frequency? What do you think happens to the basilar membrane? Just keeps moving at the same sort of up and down motion? So imagine it's much, much louder. So now the basilar membrane actually starts moving a lot more than it normally would. Do you think that damages the hair cells at all? Yeah. It does, because now you're like really moving things along. It will actually shear off those cilia. Those cilia at the very top, what do they control? They control those tip links. They control the opening and closing of those channels. That regulation is now gone, and all you hear now, or all you have now, is the continuous influx of excitatory of potassium. And so what your hearing picks that up as is sort of this low noise all the time, because there's no way to stop the activation of any of your hair cells. They've all been damaged at every frequency because of this rapid vibration. And that only disappears when the tip links actually and the stereocilia grow back. It takes a few days. For young people, you can do this. Older people, they don't have this capacity anymore. So once you've damaged your hearing as you get older and you have that ringing, it takes either a really long time or it'll never go away, unfortunately. So it's one of those things that physiologically, I want you to understand the importance of those different tip links. Again, these auditory signals, you have two ears, and as a result, these signals from the left and right ear also do some crossing over, just like in the visual system. They will go to specific nuclei found at the level of the medulla. They will also send information to the cerebellum. They will send projections up to the midbrain. As with every sense, they will send axons to the thalamus before going into the auditory cortex in the temporal lobe region. But this is actually really important. Because information is being sent up two different parts or two different routes, you can actually localize sound. So even if you're blindfolded or sitting in a dark room and you hear sound coming from the right, you're able to localize that sound because you make use of the cues from the two different ears that are detecting the sound waves. So if the sound is louder in the right ear, for example, than the left, you automatically know, your brain computes that for you, that it's coming from the right side of your head. And this loudness is actually conveyed by an increase in action potential frequency from the right side. And if the sound reaches the right ear before the left, again, it makes sense that the amplitude is going to be bigger on the right side of the head as well. So I'm just going to go through really quickly the three types of hearing loss. There's conductive hearing loss. Sound can't actually be transmitted from the external or middle ear into the inner ear. So you might damage the bones. The malleus, incus, and stapes might be damaged. You might have ruptured your eardrum, and that can happen as well. You might have central hearing loss, where you have damaged your cortex. Somehow, either through a stroke, through a head injury, the cortex that's involved in hearing might be affected. And then there is sensory neural hearing loss. So the damage to the hair cells in the inner ear, we can't replace these easily. And so these dead hair cells, if you completely lose them, I'm not talking about the loss of the tip links or the cilia. I'm talking about the total annihilation of the hair cells completely. There's no way to replace them. Birds can, they have this capacity to be able to do this. And this is one of the reasons why, as your parents get older, why they have a loss of hearing. They're losing their hair cells, right? So it's one of those things that is a bigger deal nowadays, especially with an aging population, to understand what's going on. And I'll just leave this sort of as the last slide, and then I'll make a few comments about the upcoming term test, and then we'll leave a little bit early. So cochlear implants are actually one of those really cool things. It's actually a little microphone and a processor and a transmitter that's fitted in right behind the ear. You might have seen individuals, I'm not talking about a hearing aid, which is really like a little speaker that sits over the ear. I'm talking about actually having an implanted hearing aid, and sometimes you'll see that sort of sitting on the outside of the ear on someone who's experiencing hearing loss. And this will actually convert sound into electrical impulses. So I mentioned to you a few last lecture that we're getting better and better at these brain-controlled interfaces. We can actually communicate with the nervous system by finding ways to directly convert signals into electrical signals that your brain can actually recognize. The first place that we were actually successful with this was in the auditory system. And so if we hear radio waves or compression of air, we can actually convert that fairly easily through a mathematical algorithm into electrical signals that your brain can then decode. It takes time, by the way. When you get that implant, the person can't really understand what you're saying because they've never had experience with it. They have to learn how to be able to use this, but they can adapt really quickly to the impulses coming in from this cochlear implant. And these electrodes are the ones that relay the signals directly to the cochlea or to the auditory nerve in case there is damage physically to the cochlea or to the nerve itself. Again, they have to be trained to do this. They don't hear like right away. It's not like, oh, suddenly I can understand your speech. It takes them time to be able to make sense of the sounds that they're hearing, but it works so well that they can actually engage in normal conversation. And it's one of those great things to hear about the successes of these brain-controlled or brain-computer interfaces that is so popular nowadays. So just a couple of things about your upcoming term test. So I'm going to ask you to go back over the sections that I spent the most time on, especially the biochemical parts that I've been relaying to you in today's lecture, whether it's chemosensory or others. I'm going to make sure it's okay with Dr. Key, but I'm going to post a couple of practice questions from a couple of different tests so you can see what types of questions I've asked in the past. I'm also going to be on the discussion board over the weekend in case you need to ask any questions. I'll try to monitor that. You can also try emailing me. And on Tuesday, if you have like any last minute questions that you want to ask, you can drop by the office. My office is over in New College. I'm more than happy to take any questions that you might have. Actively, like there are a lot of notes. Don't try to memorize, like, this is trigeminal nerve number 5. This is what's involved in this particular sense. I didn't really cover it. I didn't emphasize it. And I'm not going to be trying to trick you with stuff that I didn't cover at all in any of the lectures. So have a great Victoria Day weekend. Sorry to ruin your long weekend for you. And hopefully you'll have good luck on your term test on Tuesday.